when she left Oxford with her master in international relations to do amazing work in Ukraine at the intersection of arts and politics, of which she's going to say much more today, I wasn't surprised. And you're not surprised that I wasn't surprised, Miro, because Miro had been doing wonderful work exactly in that spirit with me and with CIS, trying to think through how we can bring artistic expressions of all kinds to what we do in this kind of semi-dry topic of politics and international relations, and how the two spheres should not be divorced. And Miro is extremely creative and extremely open person, and she also led a film group showing films that we would discuss. And of course, I can't hide that it was hard to follow your act, Miro, for other students after you left.
They managed for 2 years, I think.
They did. So we'll revive it yet again. But they did. You showed the way. You were a trailblazer here, Miro. And for this, I'm extremely and eternally grateful. And this is why you then, after leaving, became
curator.
Not just a curator back home, but you were associated with my center, the CIS. And I won't say more, but so I simply wanted to say how happy I am that you're back.
What we're talking about today is contested territory. In the division of our centers and our areas of interest around the university, some of those map onto old Cold War maps and perhaps post-Cold War maps as well. And those maps are shifting, so it's time to actually dialogue with each other more. So the title of her MPhil thesis, which was successfully presented in 2014, was Trojan Horses in a Cold War, Art Exhibitions as an Instrument of Cultural Diplomacy, 1945 to 1985. You're a historian, as much as a curator and an expert on international relations. And this thesis looked at the Soviet organization of particular exhibitions beyond the Soviet Union to project soft power of various kinds and to specific audiences. It was calibrated quite carefully to those audiences. I warmly recommend at least searching for the abstract to see the depth of reasoning there. Miro has written quite a lot. She's got a big back catalog. And online you can see that she's published on feminist activism in the 1960s, on the political decommunizing of the poet Taras Shevchenko in Ukraine, on Shevchenko's image in China. She's written journalism on the political significance of cinema and the arts in Ukraine and the region and beyond. And she's written conference papers and delivered conference papers on the status of art, and indeed, how to run a gallery in wartime Ukraine. Miroslava Hartmann is the owner and managing director of a gallery, Triptych Global Arts Workshop in Kyiv, and she and her family have an extensive collection of fine art in Ukraine it's quite a beautiful website, actually, worth seeking out. For her work for the arts in Ukraine, she has appeared on the media in Ukraine defending the role of the arts and explaining the role of the arts in diplomacy, and she's been named a cultural leader by the EU Eastern Partnership Program in 2015. So it's a real pleasure to turn the floor over to Miro and her talk from Leningrad to Lendenfall.
Well, thank you so much. I'm going to remain seated just for the sake of setting this up as more of an informal event. I was kind of wondering whether I should deliver the paper proper or I should do my usual conference spiel with the PowerPoint, but I'm going to stop somewhere halfway and hopefully do a bit of both. And really, this is a chance for me to share with you the result of the past 3 years of thinking and doing and talking and then thinking again, in the hope that it would open up a wider debate about the role of statues in the public space, and also hopefully provide another prism through which we can look at the regional the regional challenges that the former Soviet Union faces. So I also wanted to thank Calypso for her unfaltering support these past 3 years, and for Dan as well for keeping in touch. And thank you. So we are now living through a very interesting year in history, 2017. Of course, we're 100 years on from the Russian Revolution, also known as the October Revolution, also known as the Bolshevik coup. I mean, one event, but so many different interpretations. And the legacy of this event has really touched upon all manner of different spheres. I gave a conference paper on Coco Chanel and white emigres in Paris and how that influenced the course of fashion history at Essex a few months ago. And it was really stunning to be in a room full of sort of trained historians whose minds were absolutely blown that you could actually give a thesis using something as far out there, from your normal historical remit as Coco Chanel. But I think I managed to build a persuasive argument. Really, the point of this is that any regime change and really any geopolitical watershed, any major event, results in all manner of different things, some of them beautiful, some of them less so. I mean, this is a photograph from the 1930s showing the blowing up of the Christ the Savior Cathedral in Moscow, which for a time became the largest, the place where it stood became the largest open air swimming pool in the world. Then in the late 90s, it was rebuilt already when Russia was the successor state of the Soviet Union. It was rebuilt with some alterations to suit the tastes of the new Russian elite. And of course, it entered the mainstream media attention after Pussy Riot's famous iconoclastic performance within the rebuilt Christ the Savior Cathedral. When it was blown up in the 1930s, the cathedral was a symbol of Tsarist oppression, of widespread disease, illiteracy, terrible infrastructure that pretty much completely ignored everything that lay outside of the centers, of the imperial centers, such as St. Petersburg, Moscow, Kiev to a certain extent. And in its place was meant to stand the Palace of the Soviets, which was supposed to become the tallest building in the world. So again, we're coming back to this monumental language of totalitarian regimes. Everything has to be the tallest or the largest or the deepest. This gigantomania is something that we will keep in mind as we move through the region where the forms over the Soviet Union used to be. But it was never to be built. By 1937, its steel foundations were all pretty much dismantled because the steel was needed for the war effort and for the arms race that Stalin was now preparing for. But as late as 1948, the Palace of the Soviets appeared on propaganda posters and even in film reels in sort of model form. And it was still such a big part of the myth of Soviet progress and really the might and the power of the Soviet state. The Palace of the Soviets was supposed to be surmounted by a gigantic statue of Lenin. I mean, the height was never quite decided on because, of course, it depended on the plinth and on the final engineering challenges of the project. But in the final version, the index finger of this Lenin was to reach 4 meters in length. So you can extrapolate from that. It was, of course, never built. Every regime has its own iconography and its own aesthetic and visual language to draw from. And I think it would be short-sighted to say that statues of political leaders are no longer erected in the modern world, because of course they are in some parts of the world. However, we are undergoing a period of increased vigilance as far as our plinths and our public spaces are concerned. This is a photo taken in the first days of the Roads Must Fall campaign, which of course made its way to Oxford. So a statue that is part of an architectural ensemble that was standing for hundreds of years and maybe only got the odd jab, a verbal one at that, it had gone unnoticed but suddenly became the focus of international media attention. And really, it is within this global sea change, this global symbolic stock-taking operation that we situate, you know, our present talk about Lenin fall and about, well, the monumental legacy of communism. This is a photograph taken in 2014 when the Lenin statue was toppled in Kharkiv, a city central east Ukraine, and one of the largest centers, the former capital of Soviet Ukraine, which had one of the largest, most imposing, and most architecturally cogent Lenin statues. So I will begin by sharing with you a part of the paper, but we will keep coming back to the slides to look at things in more depth. So when David Löwenthal asserted in 1985 that the past is a foreign country, he was probably unaware of the poignancy of his titular metaphor that would take on in describing the post-Soviet world's relationship to its socialist heritage. The urban landscape of the Eastern Bloc was once known for its uniformity and coherence, a place where ideology was expressed through aesthetics. As the wave of transformational changes swept across Eastern Europe in 1989 to 1991, the USSR quite literally became a foreign country for the former 15 Soviet republics and the satellite states. The illusion of commonality shattered into a range of contending visions, communist state symbols became desacralized virtually overnight, and each incumbent government was tasked with curating an unwieldy plethora of monumental propaganda according to their own judgment. Russia, where the capital still has the revolutionary leader's mortal remains on display, and Belarus have left communist symbols largely untouched, and many monuments have retained their prominent positions in urban and rural centers. Poland and Hungary de-Sovietized their public spaces gradually, with less enthusiasm and celerity than did the Baltic states, which decreed the removal of Soviet statuary almost immediately upon gaining independence. East Germany, Romania, Moldova, and Bulgaria adopted a piecemeal approach to cleansing the public space of evidence of the former Soviet affiliation of their previous governments. Ukraine went through three phases of decommunization, the latest precipitated by a wave of iconoclastic violence known as Lenin Fall, which sparked during the Euromaidan protests, subsequently known as the Revolution of Dignity, and became state policy from 2015 onwards. So I'm going to look at the diagnostic quality of Lenin, and I think of Lenin statues. And what I mean by that is, coming back to what Dan said, some of these aesthetic and political processes map quite well onto what we know about the region from our Cold War 101. So in the states where we expect them to be still standing, such as Russia and Belarus, they are indeed pretty much still there. And in the states where we know they got rid of them as soon as independence was proclaimed, such as the Baltic states, you will be really hard tasked to find a Lenin freestanding. They are still there, but just not in their official position on the plinth in the city and town and village centers. But there are certain gray areas, and what I have tried to do by observing the national and the international media, and also interviewing state officials, artists, activists in the past 3 years is to see how attitudes within Ukraine changed to this monumental heritage. And Ukraine sort of became a gray area in our Cold War 101 understanding of where Lenin should be standing, because of course Ukraine is the second largest Soviet republic. So across 600,000 kilometers, you had a good many Lenins. And this Lenin density is something that Calypso brought my attention to when we spoke about this about a year ago, that this is something that I should really, really focus on and look at. So the Soviet monumental vocabulary divided quite conveniently into two broad tropes. One was the revolutionary statuary, so the revolutionary myth, which commemorated Lenin as well as important events that pivoted around that transformational event. But the second trope was, of course, the great patriotic war memorials. And by that we mean that part of the Second World War, which the USSR focused on in its narrative of history, that being 1941 to 1945, only that period. And it has subsequently always been known in Russian language and Ukrainian language, basically the local languages of the former Soviet Union, as the Great Patriotic War. And really that related to the ideological and military triumph of the Soviet Union over Nazism, over the Nazi regime. And this is a painting from the 1970s by a Ukrainian artist that shows the great Patriotic War Memorial Park in Kiev. The pinnacle of it is, of course, the Motherland Memorial, which is one of the top 10 highest statues in the world. It's I believe, twice as tall as the Statue of Liberty, no less iconic in the former Soviet bloc, of course. And it was a triumph of engineering and of monumental art at its time. And of course, all of this surrounded area, which is situated on rolling hills around the Dnieper River on the right bank, all of this can still be seen. And one of the things which Ukraine has really been struggling with in the light of present geopolitical challenges is the reconsideration of the Soviet narrative of the events that took place on its territory during that time. So, for example, the Great Patriotic War Memorial. This used to be the military museum which bore that name, but now it is the Second World War Museum. So increasingly, Ukraine is taking on more Western taxonomies for these important events. This is the sister of the Motherland Monument in Kiev. This is in Volgograd, former Stalingrad. The reason why this photo is useful for our understanding of this topic is because it gives you a very good idea of the lay of the land. It gives you a kind of bird's eye view of the city planning, and you can see that the planning, I mean the pin in the urban monumental balloon, so to speak, is indeed this statue. So if you were to imagine that statue was removed, the urban landscape would suddenly look very, very different, because of course your eye from any point in the city is drawn towards this important place. And this goes to show just how focal the Soviet official interpretation of events is to our understanding of urban planning of the time, especially in newer cities such as former Stalingrad, of course. The siege of Stalingrad, the battle for Stalingrad, all of these are undisputedly important events, and of course, such as was the battle for Kiev, of course. But it's just the way these events are situated within the global narrative. There's a kind of Soviet exceptionalism that comes, that is expressed even through branding, you know, the Soviet part of the war effort within the Second World War as the Great Patriotic War, in a way showing that it was an event of exclusive proportion and significance that somehow doesn't fit in with the global historical narrative. So this is another statue which is also very, very important to our discussion. This is the Lenin statue, which was the first to fall. So the process that subsequently became known as Lenin Fall started here. And this statue is significant for a number of reasons. It was crafted by Stalin's favorite architect and sculptor, Sergei Mogilev. He was the author, or he was the sculptor behind the massive Lenin project for the Palace of the Soviets. So he crafted the model. And here, Vladimir Ilyich strikes a pose that would subsequently be known as the Merkurovskaya poza, so the Merkurov pose. Lenin is shown standing, so this is a full-length standing sculpture, and he is sort of directed upwards, and there is some speculation whether or not Merkurov tried to portray him like Hermes or Mercury in the classical vertilinear pose. The other significant thing about it is the material that it is crafted out of. So this is rose quartzite, a very precious stone which is found in parts of Africa, but also Karelia, now, well, on the Russo-Finnish border, very precious stone that was, of course, mined by the prisoners of the gulags, and indeed the monument to the victims of gulag repressions in St. Petersburg, or one of them, is a large piece of red quartzite. And perhaps some of you have seen it, but this is very important. This is the Merkurov pose. You can kind of see the elongated proportions within this painting from 1976 by Anatoly Plamenitsky. Again, the statue is a focal point for celebration and for collective ritual. Here we see a little Oktoberis on a warm September day in Kiev receiving their pins. So they've been accepted into the Little Oktoberists, which is the precursor to the Young Pioneers for preschool children. And they get a pin depicting Lenin as a child put on their pinafores. And of course, we see the flags of the other Soviet republics. Again, this collective identity is emphasized again and again. And of course, this painting is created in the official method, well, style, socialist realism, which is a kind of aspirational art form that gives you a projection of reality and of the future as it should be, and hopefully motivates its viewers into making this a reality. This is the same monument in December 2018. So as tensions were mounting near the Maidan, so the Maidan is the main square in Kiev, which is it's in the middle of Kryshchatyk, which is the main street, or the high street. And this is the Shevchenko Boulevard. So it's one of the main streets that come off the main street. So Kryshchatyk is here. The Maidan is somewhere over here, and this is the Shevchenko Boulevard, and this is a statue of Lenin, which has been there since 1939. What is it still doing there in 2013 in independent Ukraine? Why has it not been removed? And why is the riot police seemingly protecting this statue from protesters, peaceful protesters that are gathering here? Well, Stalin gifted the statue to Kiev in 1939 after it came back from the New York World's Fair, where it made an appearance in the Soviet Pavilion. And he wanted to give this statue to Kiev to reinforce the link between the city of Moscow and the city of Kiev, because red quartzite is in fact the material that is used to decorate the innermost chamber of the mausoleum. This is the sarcophagus in the mausoleum. And red quartzite detailing is used both for the body of the sarcophagus, but also the facade of the mausoleum. And again, the color of the stone, of course, it's red, and it's found, it tends to have quite a uniform formation. It has a pure color that we find in nature again and again, that allows for using it for the architectural detailing of larger constructions. And this is the burial chamber. This, perhaps you recognize, is the tomb of Napoleon in Les Invalides, which also uses Karelian red quartzite. Several particularly large slabs that the French government purchased from the Russian imperial crown court. So again, we are reinforcing that link between leaderships and between different, imperial myths and their challenges, and the Soviet Union and the Kremlin. So to have a red quartzite statue of Lenin standing in the center of Kiev back in 1939 would have again re-emphasized this materiality of the Lenin myth. And this is the fate that that befell on the statue, and we return to the idea of symbolic violence. The first Lenin to fall was indeed this one, and one of the reasons for this was because in the context of the Euromaidan protest, the riot police, which was aligned with the ousted Yanukovych regime, congregated around the Lenin, because, well, it was, I guess, a prominent meeting point and strategically important to prevent more people from entering from this part of the city. But they just visually, in the heat of the moment, seemed aligned with the old and with the present Putin regime that draws a lot of its symbolic currency from the previous years of the Soviet regime. So when Ukraine seceded from the Soviet Union in 1991, it inherited a plethora of monumental propaganda from its predecessor. This being one example. Of Lenin alone, there were 5,500 statues. And if I could just, yeah, there we go. So Lenin density. In 1991, Russia had 7,000 Lenins, and by 2013 it had 6,000. Ukraine, by 2015, this is the sort of the tail end of Lenin fall. This is what this shows. Ukraine.
Sorry, Miro. The current one, is it those still standing in the same place or those that are still somewhere?
Oh, yeah. So
the two fates that you...
Exactly. So we are talking about Lenin statues that are officially installed on plinths where the Soviet administration would have wanted them. So not physically present in the country within memorial parks or museum collections or private collections, or just taken off the plinth and put somewhere else. So in 1991, so the 1991 bark, is, I know the writing is quite small, but it's shown in red. So in red, you see the bar. So you have, this axis shows you the countries, all the regions. and the red bar is 1991. The pink bar is 2015, like after the majority of the Lenins have been toppled in Ukraine, to show you the difference. So Russia had 7,000. Ukraine had 5,500. So if you consider the size of Russia, which is described as vast many more times, we will hear it described as vast probably that's the main epithet that we associate with Russia when we hear kind of descriptions of it. It's vast, and it had 7,000 Lenins, fair enough. But Ukraine is pretty big, much smaller though, 5,500. So the Lenin density, I actually did work it out at one point, but it didn't make too much sense. So use your imagination to then extrapolate, you know, that number of Lenins onto the map. A lot higher. In fact, I had a really interesting conversation with some friends last night, some friends from Latvia, and I asked them, I was telling them about the Baltic states, and I said that in the Baltic states, there were about 200 or 150. But within Latvia, Latvia had two-thirds of all the Lenins in the Baltic states, which we sort of clump into one group. And what they suggested was that in Latvia, the policy of Russification was always a lot harsher. So perhaps that is a factor that accounts for the larger number of Lenins in Latvia. In Ukraine, by 2015, so by the time the official decommunization laws were passed in May, there were about just over 1,000. So the drop in the number of Lenins can be accounted for in the following ways. Ukraine had three waves of so-called decommunization. Let's call it Lenin removal. So Lenin was removed in Ukraine during these three waves. This is the first wave, which, well, here it says it started in 1990, but in fact it started even earlier. It started in 1988. By one of the decrees, there was kind of a fine print, which gave greater authority to regional administration in deciding upon that public environment, upon the monuments that were displayed in the public environment. The Galicia administration in western Ukraine decided to interpret it thus. They removed all statues of Lenin on Dzerzhinsky. They removed some of the marks, reliefs, and busts that they had. And by 1991, in fact, they didn't have any Lenins. And this is the Galicia administration, which was instrumental in establishing the Western Ukrainian Republic in 1939. And that is what traditionally has a much more, had much fiercer opposition to the Soviet regime. So as late as the perestroika years, some local administrations took advantage of this. But of course, in 1991, with the fall of the Soviet Union, suddenly Ukraine was left with all these Lenins that really were the expression of a regime that was no longer extant. And we see here a photograph from 1991 showing the removal of the main Lenin in Ukraine. So this was the Lenin in the Maidan, the former Red Square of Kiev, not Moscow. And scrawled upon, I can't see at that angle, but scrawled upon, yeah, we see that swastikas, pentagrams, and also this, which says, it says idol in Ukrainian, so idol. As well as I think there was some anarchist graffiti on the plinth, but this symbolic alignment of Lenin, with the Nazi regime, but I guess the swastika is also a symbol of evil for a lot of people. So we see this shift, and the Lenin is removed. It was a sculptural group that was removed. Gradually, but that was done. So the Lenin that we saw earlier, the red quartzite Lenin, was really the only Lenin that by 2013 was still standing in Kiev. Kiev, although there were over 20 of them. The second wave came in 2000. What started really in 2000 and ended in 2004. So there we go. More than 600 were removed. That really doesn't really map onto to any particular regime change or geopolitical challenge. But the third wave does, and that is, of course, 2005. So after the Orange Revolution, which brought President Viktor Yushchenko into power, Yushchenko, by presidential decree, orders the removal of even more monuments. Very interesting, because, of course, the Orange Revolution was a mass peaceful protest that expressed the will of the Ukrainian people to turn to Europe as its geopolitical defense and socio-political orientation, rather than to the east, to the Kremlin. And for Yushchenko, cultural policy was one of his main platforms through which he popularized what he did, I suppose. So we see that although in the second and the third wave, the same number of monuments were removed roughly, there was a big song and dance about this one, but less so here. And in Ukraine, especially in recent years, the removal of communist monuments and symbols is often portrayed through the national media and through spokespeople of different political forces as being a sign of progress. So you might, you might see something in the paper like 100 communist symbols removed in the Odessa region, and that is then, then you have this piece that basically tells you, presents it as an achievement of the local government or of a particular politician that really pushed for that removal, or in fact for the present regime. So it becomes a populist platform because, of course, removing a monument could be done routinely and in an organized fashion, but it can also be politicized. That act can be political or it could be routine. The second time it became a really political act was, of course, like the so-called fourth wave, when in 2013 the first Lenin was toppled, and across Ukraine, many activists followed suit and started destroying Lenin monuments in various ways, either destroying them by taking them off their plinths or by damaging parts of the monuments, repainting them in Ukrainian colors, as we saw in the beginning, in the very first title slide, or by modifying them in some way, so upcycling them. So this is a window display within the National History Museum, and this shows a part of the Lenin monument within the booth that talks about the Revolution of Dignity. So kind of lasting symbolic significance. A few other interesting notes, because of course, while my focus is on Ukraine, this fits really into a wider debate. Some really interesting things. We can see in Belarus and Russia, the numbers, they had gone down. That can be accounted for because a lot of the monuments were taken down for restoration and then disappeared in private hands. But the framework within which they were taken down is, of course, very different. It was like, we need to preserve this statue. We need to take it down and restore it. And a lot of those didn't really come back onto the plinths. Many of them were made from precious materials, marble, granite, various other stones. In Mongolia, there was a huge number of Lenins that I really didn't realize looking at it, although not the former Soviet Union. Indeed, the one of the former satellite states, a great number of Lenins. However, in Central Asia,
there was but a fraction in Central Asia, the whole region really, so all the stands, about a quarter, in total, about a quarter of the number of learners that were in Mongolia alone. And how do we account for this difference in learner density? A lot of that comes to, well, there are different levels to it. A lot of the monuments were erected by decree of local administration. So it could be, for example, the willingness of a particular administration to show their loyalty to the Kremlin, and therefore they're overzealous in populating their prince with learners. Or it could be enforced. In Ukraine, the first Lenin appeared in 1919, really in the turbulent years of the Civil War, and it was erected by Bolsheviks and, well, Bolshevik forces within Ukraine. It was then taken down again. It was made out of very bad quality materials, as were a lot of the revolutionary monuments in the early years. But then again, a more permanent one was often put in their place. So even though we do have already some keys to understanding why Lenins do in fact appear, there are still these gaps in understanding. Why so many in Mongolia? You know, why so few in Central Asia? On the plinth here is a chart that shows you how many Lenins were removed or toppled in a non-sanctioned manner. The important thing is that in May 2015, the new Ukrainian government, after the change of regime, so under President Poroshenko, passed a series of decommunization laws, which outlawed, which deprived all Lenin and Dzerzhinsky monuments, as well as monuments to other communist figures, of heritage status. So, regardless of the material, regardless of the history, regardless of the significance, if it's a statue of a political leader, then it does not have the status of a cultural heritage object, and therefore it falls outside of the regime protection, conservation regime. Also, it outlawed the display of communist and Nazi symbols in any form of political or social life, except within the context of museum exhibitions and research initiatives, where it is clearly shown that the purpose of the display is educational or academic. So that suddenly applied, that ban suddenly applied to five political parties within Ukraine alone that used in one form or another communist symbols in their party branding. And really it was an attack directly against the Communist Party that was seen as one of the sources of destabilizing the new regime. So really the decommunization laws cast a net that was much, much wider than just Lenin monuments. And actually most of them had already been removed by the time they were passed. So here we go from December 2013, first Lenin that was toppled, through to, well, the month of February, 376 toppled by activists, really acting of their own accord, and some more sort of gradual removals up until February 2015. In May, decommunization laws were passed, but already that revolutionary momentum had died down. Not everyone in Ukraine was for Lenin fall. In fact, in places like Kharkiv, and some of you will recognize the Gazprom buildings in the background, an important landmark really in the history of the constructivist movement in architecture. In the 1920s, the main square in Kharkiv was designed as the largest square in Europe. And the constructivist architecture behind Lenin really was a triumph of architecture and design at the time, that used new building materials, new techniques, new means of organizing space to provide light and maximum communal working spaces, even within the government buildings. Of course, the Lenin statue, again, was part of the architectural ensemble, so we see the very modernist, simple plinth, the pose. A lot of the people of Kharkiv protested and against the removal when they feared that activists might topple Lenin, and that, in fact, that the new government might sanction their actions. And here we have signs, this is, for example, Bandera ne nash heroi, so Bandera is not our hero. Bandera is what was a Western Ukrainian nationalist leader who actually collaborated with the Nazis on the territory of Western Ukraine. And in some parts of Ukraine is hailed as a national hero, in other parts vilified. So again, suddenly everything becomes polarized. You're either for Lenin or you're for Bandera. Although, of course, on the bell curve of people's political views, very few would fall on either extremes. But in times of crisis, in times of revolution, war, these symbols of past regimes become recontextualized within the new political context. So the protests did not protect Lenin from similar fate. And again, we see slogans scrawled on the plinth. So here it says, Slava Ukraini, glory to Ukraine. And I don't know if that's intentional, because this is a reportage photo, but even in the smoke flares, we see blue and yellow colors of Ukraine. But this is one of the pictures that featured in the media most prominently, possibly because of this aspect here. So what became of the plinth of Mirkurov's red quartzite Lenin? One of the most interesting things for me as a researcher was to see how different social groups and different professional groups responded to the challenge of answering the question, who or what should replace Lenin? And the empty plinth in Taras Shevchenko Boulevard was, of course, now one of thousands of plinths all across Ukraine that no longer had Lenin, but that needed some kind of aesthetic or political resolution. And one of the most interesting projects was organized by Izolyatsiya, Platform for Cultural Initiatives, worked with the Kyiv City Administration to create an open call for art projects that went out to artists all over the world, so not just within Ukraine, but all over the world. And there were a lot of interesting proposals, and they decided not to choose one project, but to use the plinth as an exhibition space and to show different interpretations of what should go on top of the plinth on a rotational basis. So sometimes you see displays that go on for 3 weeks, sometimes just one day. There was an interesting one by a Mexican artist, Silvia Gutierrez, who created a kind of stairway that went up the plinth and then back down again. And you were invited to sort of walk up, surmount the plinth, look around, and see what Lenin would have seen, and then go down again. And that was really a kind of participative performance piece that called for the reappraisal of the role of plinths in our cities, and that gave everyone a chance to experience for themselves the rise and fall. Some of you may recognize this from the international media. So this is an example. This is in Odessa. This is not in the city center, but on the territory of one of the factories, because most of the factories in the Soviet Union would have had some form of Lenin statue, whether it was a full, you know, a full length one, and that showed that this was a very important factory, or a bus, or indeed a plinth, but they would have figured somewhere. Alexander Milov is an Odessa-based Ukrainian sculptor, and he decided to upcycle Lenin and create a Darth Vader statue. There is now a plaque on the plinth that in fact says Darth Vader from the Grateful Children of the World. So this is an interesting example that shows you the different solutions, the different creative solutions that flooded to replace the political decision-making vacuum that emerged when it became clear that really no one government, no one political force had an aesthetic project or an aesthetic vision with which to amend the cities of Ukraine and emphasize, you know, the decision of the people to live in a different way. And this statue is significant because it plays on a number of different levels. Because of course Darth Vader is a villain. Well, Darth Vader is a villain, but he had a life before he became Darth Vader, and in the end he was redeemed. So to me, this statue points to the gap between Lenin, the revolutionary leader, and in fact Lenin, a man of flesh and blood and a historical figure, then his image as it was presented by the Soviet propaganda machine after his death, and Lenin as he is today, as a kind of meme, a kind of mimetic unit of meaning, really divorced from its original political context. And Alexander Milov plays with these different meanings. And actually, one of his sculptures was featured in this year's Burning Man, which was a huge deal for Ukraine, you know, to have one of its sculptures contribute to an event of such global significance. This is another interesting one. This is Zhanna Kadyrova's Monument to a Monument. And what is significant here is really that which surrounds the plinth. You know, chain link fences, painted blue and yellow, the national colors of Ukraine. So it's not just about the fact that Lenin is no longer there. It's about what remains, really. An infrastructure that could be better, the periphery, really outside of city centers. You really see the effect that the war is having on the public spaces, on the environment, that the economic crisis is having on the urban environment. It's no good to just get rid of symbols of a past that ended really a quarter of a century ago now. So when we looked at the different waves of decommunization, we get an increasing disconnect in time and space and meaning from the original regime that all the way back here gave reason for the installation of these Lenin monuments. And it's no good to declare that you've removed over 600 units of meaning of an abominable regime and to do so little or indeed nothing for the actual public environment within which these statues would have been situated. And this, to me, this really reminded me of a painting from the early 1980s by Nikolai Chernikov, an interesting artist in the turbulent years of the perestroika in Ukraine, because his father taught within the Art Academy. His father was an official artist. He was a member of the artists' unions. He was also a civil servant, in a sense, because he administrated art education. He was an influential man who was commissioned to paint portraits of Stalin, who fought in the cavalry during the Second World War. And Nikolai, although, of course, also a member of the National Union of Artists, had trouble meeting the requirements of the socialist realist method. And in fact, this painting shows, this photograph shows a painting that was rejected by the art fund. So he got a commission to create a painting on the theme of monuments. And normally, you know, there was a list of approved themes, and of which you can choose and interpret one, and then the state would buy the painting from you and really pay you directly. There was no private art market as we know it in the Soviet Union. Officially, there wasn't. And he painted this, he created this. This is a sizable painting. It's really about the size of this photograph. Obviously, made countless sketches and prep work, and then when he showed this to the commission, they rejected it. Because, of course, it did not conform to the method of socialist realism. It's far too expressive, it's far too expressionistic, it's far too occulted. And we see a monument that really looks a lot like it's a shrouded figure. Beneath it is something that is probably not going to motivate the people of the surrounding towns and villages to build a better communist future. It's something abominable. We are afraid to look beneath the shroud and tear the sheet off the face of this dying world. And this is an installation, so we don't just have sculptural interpretations of the problem, but also ones within the infrastructure of contemporary art, so installations, performances. This installation says Lenin's Heart, and Yevgenia Belarusets did an installation called Let's Put Lenin's Head Back Together Again, within the Pinchuk Art Center. So Viktor Pinchuk, known as an oligarch, of course, Ukrainian businessman, with, married to the daughter of one of the former Ukrainian presidents, a lot of interests in the now occupied territories. And he, in the mid-2000s, created the Pinchuk Art Center, which is a contemporary, it's a non-profit organization that has an art space in central Kiev, which is right there. That's one of the posters on the front of the Pinchuk Art Center. So you could, in theory, witness this from the coffee shop on top of the Pinchuk Art Center. So soon after, really one of the first projects to give a critical response to what was happening was Let's Put Lenin's Head Together Again, Back Together Again, by Yevgenia Belarusets, that took place in the Pinchuk Art Center. Shameless self-promotion. Niels Ackermann, Swiss photojournalist who has been working in Ukraine ever since the 2010 presidential elections, went all over Ukraine to see and to document what happened to the Lenin statues and how the treatment of the Lenin statues varied. I presented at a conference in Cambridge about a year ago where one of the discussants, Julie Deschapelle, who actually just organized a really interesting conference / exhibition in Paris about the role of the Soviet monumental heritage in France, shared a term called semioclasm, which I had never heard before. So it's in a book by Thoreau, a recent book, but it's not something that I've really seen appearing in the literature very much, semioclasm. So the idea of damaging something, but not quite, sort of changing it as you damage it and amending it. And here, this is in Shabol, in the Odessa Oblast, in the Odessa region, in a small sort of town center. And Lenin has been decapitated. He's been painted gold, and there's also a Ukrainian flag that's been added to the plinth. And again, you know, what is the motivation of these activists? Well, you can't give a coverall answer to that question, because the activists, these nameless hundreds that did various things to various monuments, acted, you know, had different motivations. The Lenins were toppled in very different parts of Ukraine, and the monuments themselves were very different. This is also from Neil Sackerman's Looking for Lenin book. I actually got invited to write the introduction to the book, which I've got a few copies with me. Which, you know, answered the question, why is Lenin 4 different? Why is it different to all the other instances of Lenin removals in Ukraine? And why is it different, you know? Why is it a unique phenomenon, both historically and globally? And really, the biggest difference is that it was a period of time when the largest number of monuments were removed in the broadest territory without any kind of sanction from the state. It wasn't state policy. Really, people acted off their own accord. And another interesting, unique thing about it was the temporal disconnect. So we go from 1991, the fall of communism, all the way to 2013. Lenin no longer just means the Kremlin, you know, the USSR, of the USSR. It means the Kremlin of Putin's regime. And this kind of strange atomization of meanings that then came into one symbol, the Lenin statue, that is unique and significant. This takes you through some of the travels. So yeah, I talked about private ownership. So this is someone's garage, for lack of a better word. You know, you can see some paintings of Lenin. Again, some paintings there. You see this. So this is a statue that probably would have been taken from inside a building, a public building, rather than one outside. But you can see, you know, a collector or a salvager who is, hoarding or hiding. This is the National Museum, NAMU, National Art Museum of Ukraine, which shows some marble Lenins by some of the most renowned artists. And they are, they created a kind of plywood box that went around Lenin that was right in the foyer while all of this was going on. During the Euromaidan protests, the staff of the National Art Museum, which is right next to the Maidan, barricaded themselves in with the collection and held siege for about a month. And you know, were there on a rotational basis to make sure that the artworks weren't looted, weren't salvaged, so they could do as much as they could if indeed, you know, the building caught fire or was damaged in any way. And even people who, you know, were cultural workers, you know, art professionals, they realized that it's a symbol of a regime that once again becomes abhorrent and once again comes to the forefront. But that this marble statue has artistic value. It has heritage significance, and they would not let it be damaged. And just for cover, they brought in a Rodin-esque kissing topic, just to say, oh, we're just storing some stuff. And that includes two letters, one of which was damaged, indeed, during this process. The Looking for Lenin project is just so thrilled to be a part of that. It's led to some really interesting things. For example, I'm co-curating an exhibition called Fallen, Revolution, Propaganda, Iconoclasm at the Art Exchange, which is part of the University of Essex. And among the exhibits, we see a contemporary artist model of the 4-meter finger, index finger of Lenin. Postcards, sorry, it's tiny, but postcards from all over the Soviet Union and actually the world, because there's some GDR ones and some Mongolian ones, showing, ephemera basically, but showing Lenin as a tourist attraction, as well as a video of Sergei Merkurov in his studio designing, the model of that Lenin that was not to be. And of course, Niels Ackermann's photos, and we see Darth Vader by Alexander Milos. And we see the shadow Lenin as well. And a really cool thing that they did is they put an empty plinth right outside the Art Exchange, right outside the venue. And during Freshers Week, they armed the students with some Polaroids. And the drama department got involved. And they were invited to dress up and basically answer the question, who should go on top of the plinth if it's empty? So it's been a good deal of engagement. Memorial parks. I mean, some of you may recognize this as the Museum in Moscow. really cool thing, really cool bit of trivia for cocktail parties. None of these statues were actually removed from where they were standing. They came from museum collections. They were surplus Lenins. So unlike the Grūtas Park in Lithuania, unlike the Memento Park in Hungary, a memorial park was not created to accommodate Lenins that had been removed, but rather it was created to showcase statues that otherwise would have been in museum basements and halls. So that's a very important difference between the museum in Moscow and, say, the Memento Park in Hungary and the Grūtas Park in In the US, artists like Yevgeny Fix are asking the question, what should a museum of totalitarianism look like? And of course, the red carnation in, what is that really cool? Oh, I always forget the language of flowers. It's like floriography. I'll have to look it up. In Soviet floriography, don't quote me on that. The red carnation is the flower of remembrance of the sacrifice of veterans, much like the red poppy. And of course, some incredible work has been done on Lenins in other parts of the world. The GDR is a very interesting example, which I'm not even going to go there. There's so much going on there. And that's another one of those gray spaces that doesn't quite fit into our Cold War 101 Lenin map. Outside the coast of the Crimea in Darkhankut, there's an underwater museum, which was the conceived and created by a group of underwater of diving enthusiasts, and it shows really not just Lenin as a child and then Lenin as a revolutionary leader, but a whole host of other statues, including Nadezhda Krupskaya, Lenin's wife, Dzerzhinsky, some Marxes and some Engels statues and busts are there, as well as some other really random ones. But I'd like to end on this image and invite you to make suggestions and questions, because on a long enough timeline, any serialized image, whether it's Lenin or whether it's, for example, in the British Museum, in the Egyptian collection, there are grand diorite statues of the lion-headed goddess Sekhmet, which are displayed. You see four standing one next to the other. If we are completely abstracted from the political and historical context within which they were created, there is little difference in the way that we perceive a serialized image from one context and another. And I suppose the example of Lenin's is interesting within a very highly politicized context. However, in Ukraine, for years and years and years, these statues were standing, and people didn't, well, most people didn't give them a second thought. And one of the things that we try to do in the book is we try to actually talk to the people that lived in these different towns and cities where the monuments have been toppled or remended. And the difference of opinion, the range of opinion, is so vast, whether you talk to an old lady or a teenager, or indeed one of the activists. Some people thought, you know, the Lenin should have been left standing, and they protested to say, you know, don't touch Lenin, we don't want Bandera to replace Lenin. But of course there is a range of solutions, and there have been some creative ones, such as the underwater Hall of Infamy, right outside the coast of the Crimea. So thank you very much.
Thank you for a beautiful and fascinating presentation, Miro. And I mean, you might not be surprised that as I'm listening to you in the conversation, I'm kind of asking, you know, do we have a kind of general theory of the fate of political statues, you know, in the world, and variation of that fate across countries, so including related to the Soviet era, you know, where we could kind of look at different variables like who took the initiative, official, non-official, no one, how did it happen, destroyed, moved, subverted, you know, what happens next, etc. So you could kind of more systematically, you know, kind of tell us if there is a pattern, under what condition. That would be for a kind of social science-y take on it. Maybe it's been done. But so, you know, one thing is the density, that's one aspect, but just many, these different kind of moments in the fate of these statues. And then the next question becomes whether or not trying to understand that helps us in the prescriptive side of things, which you were just talking about. And in fact, you started your presentation with our own statue problem in Oxford, of course, with Rhodes, and of course we've been following Charlottesville, etc. I mean, this is, as you say, you know, yes, maybe the West doesn't do serialize, but the West has a huge statue problem, but you know, if not problem, challenge, echoes of the past, and indeed we do ask, well, what do you do with them? Do you put them somewhere else? Do you put a little plaque that explains what they actually are, many plaques, because there are many voices and interpretation. So is it useful to look at what's happened, for instance, to Lenin's statues in Ukraine, to think about this more prescriptive, normative question? Or is it useful to you, as someone who bridges the two worlds, as an Oxford student and scholar, and a scholar of the Ukrainian story?
I mean, the short answer is yes, of course. I mean, that's the reason why I'm doing this, and this is the reason why I, you know, really wanted to situate it within a global debate, rather than saying, you know, this is a problem exclusive to Ukraine or the post-Soviet region, because we are all, well, people all over the world, both people as in, you know, the people, man on the street, and people as in politicians or decision makers are asking this question. And there's a lot of dissonant heritage which we've ignored for many years and not really noticed it, that's now becoming apparent. I didn't mention the Confederate monuments. I mean, that's really an omission. But you remember that, of course, President Trump lamented the fate of the beautiful statues. So again, that aesthetic motivation, you know, is often one that trumps others, pardon the pun. And in Ukraine, Lenin was not widely considered to be beautiful. So that aesthetic motivation was not the one that was, you know, that was not top of the list. The political one for everyone was top of the list. But in some places, such as the Red Quartz site monument, it ignored the aesthetic motivation to preserve it. So we learn from the example of Ukraine. This has been the subject of the international coverage of the decommunization processes in Ukraine. This is, I think, also a reason why a UK publisher decided to do a book about Lenin, thinking it would be interesting to a wider audience. Actually, a French language version has come out on Noir sur Blanc in the French-speaking countries as well at the same time. So again, tapping into a different national and regional audience. To me, Ukraine's experience of Lenin Fall is possibly one of its greatest contributions to the global debate of recent years. Something that we can learn from, you know, look at closely, learn from, and hopefully draw some prescriptive solutions for other situations.
Thank you very much. I have a question. Well, first of all, thank you for this incredible presentation. And I have a question that slightly departs from the main topic of Lenin Fall, because I'd like to ask you something about what I call Stalin Rise. Because one of the many ways in which I'm trying not to finish my defo has been to look into newly built Stalin monuments. And I've discovered that never since 1962 there have been that many Stalin monuments in the former Soviet Union. And one of the first and most famous cases was the Stalin monument built outside of the headquarters of the Communist Party in Zaporizhia, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Correct.
Right. And, well, I am not aware of any other major example, because I've been looking mostly at Russia, but I wanted to ask you if there have been further examples, how this has been treated as part of the current ongoing processes in Ukraine, because I would think that, well, if Lenin is a divisive figure, Stalin is almost unifying in the hatred that the overwhelming majority of people would feel for that. So I was interested to hear from you if there's something going on concerning that.
And if I can vandalize this question, just slightly. There's a movement, or there has been a movement in Georgia to deface Stalin statues, which are prolific in Georgian public space. So the pink Stalin movement, where pink paint is sloshed all over the Stalin statue. So there are dimensions to this story, I think.
Well, actually, I've departed from the text. I do mention Khrushchev's denunciation of the cult of personalities of the 20th Congress of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. This was in 1956. Khrushchev said that basically the Stalin cult of personality was a bad idea and we should do less of that. And actually, what the interesting thing is that a lot of Stalin monuments were removed under the Soviet administration at the height of the Cold War, from the 50s all the way through to the early 70s. Stalin statues were removed under the Soviet administration. Sometimes you would even get curious examples where there was a group of sculptures, for example, Lenin and Stalin, one of them sitting, one standing, or both sitting. This was a motif that was used in public parks and also seaside towns, a kind of leisurely Stalin and Lenin in conversation. The Stalin bit would be hacked off, so much so that if Lenin was touching his back, they would lop off the hand of Lenin, not even bother to put it back on properly. You know, such was the efficiency with which the Stalin statues were removed. So I think maybe what we're looking at here with both, you know, Pink Stalin and Stalin Rise, and actually Giovanni is one of the researchers doing amazing work on the GDR, and I actually sent you in paper, as you know, is that Lenin is no longer just about the Soviet Union. It's too wide a term. It's too huge a symbol. It's too much of a meme, both loathed and loved. You see Lenin caricatured so many times that Lenin alone is not powerful enough. Also, it covers too long a period of time. With what a lot of these people are trying to do, we're coming back to a very particular time in the history of the Soviet Union where there was Hazarian, you know, where you had the master, and the master said what you had to do, you had the leader, you know, you had the vozhd. And what they are missing is leadership. Stalin rise is a reaction to the crisis of leadership in the region. And the crisis of accountability, really the lack of consensus. Stalin and not Lenin symbolizes that vertical, and it symbolizes the great patriotic war and the triumph over Nazism, of which you know, these act of which they are, well, basically accusing their opponents.
So, leading on from one of the earlier questions about looking into the future, I wanted to ask you about whether there's been any memorialization so far of what happened on the Maidan and what's happening in the east of Ukraine. So I was there in Kiev in early 2015 and I saw makeshift shrines to people who died.
Yeah.
But obviously that staged nothing more permanent. So has anything happened in the interim in terms of more permanent memorialization? And has there been a similar lack of consensus over
there? Again, there have been some monuments, some permanent ones. Mostly though, they have been the result of local activists working with local administrations and fundraising through the community, rather than it coming from, you know, from the state budget in any organized fashion. I've got some really good material on that. If you're interested, I can send it to you. It's not something I've personally focused on, but it's something I've come across. And actually, answering your question, I did mention that the church does play a role, and that is in the case of local communities wanting to use the plinth as a platform for commemorating the fallen soldiers as well as other victims of recent years.
Can I ask a question about the map on the sort of graphic representation of Lenin Fall, which you have, where there are numbers, the slide before, I think, the blue slide?
Oh, no. Of course.
Yes, so these numbers, what do they represent, actually?
So where you see zero and zero, so that is this is the Galicia administration that had zero Lenins come 1991. I'll have to look because I can't, this particular one I'm not so familiar with, like I focused on this part of it.
Yes.
But this shows you the number of symbols, the index number of symbols compared to the collective number of Lenins in Ukraine. So this has the largest index, for example. This has the lowest index. So they're proportionate numbers rather than actual numbers.
I see. Yeah. Because there seems to be a correspondence between sort of concentration of Russian speaking or Russian ethnic clusters and a lower index, or in this case, a sort of higher Ukrainian national sentiment.
Yeah.
And I just wondered if you could, you know, perhaps unpack
that
a bit for
the,
us.
The darkest blue, so that's Zaporizhia, so that's the one with the largest, if I'm not mistaken. To answer your question, in short, yes, there is a regional difference in the sheer number of Lenins. You know, fewer in the west, fewer in the north to a certain extent. So, you know, we're talking about your Hungarian border and whatnot. More to the east. The Crimea is sort of a different example because the decision making for architectural and monumental construction came from the Kremlin itself always. Crimea was a very international place, you know, within the Soviet Union, so Crimea is a bit of an outlier. But as far as the other concern, more news, but it's not just about sheer number, it's also about the symbolic currency that they had in those places, both during the Soviet times and after. And actually, is it this way? Yeah. So this is an example of a Lenin that was both significant from an architectural and conservation standpoint, but also from a local standpoint. So actually, the residents of Kharkiv really you know, wanted to preserve the architect, well, the ones that demonstrated, they wanted to preserve the integrity of the Gazprom, which is a world-renowned landmark of constructivist architecture. And Menin, in this case, is a part of it. And actually, what I didn't translate, I didn't translate
yes,
this
time.
So, why don't you demolish my house? It was also built by the communists. What about our metro? You know, so it's this very kind of black and white reasoning, you know? And it's very much like they are coming to destroy our Lenin, they being other Ukrainians who worship Bandera. I mean, these guys don't worship Lenin. It's just a case of this is ours. You know, we've got our Lenin, so what? They're ours, you know, hands off. So this us and them kind of mentality, a lot of regional suspicion and antipathy as well. So Lenin is, you know, is the symptom, it's the diagnostic in a way. This is what I focused on to see the debate around it, and it has such a power, Lenin has such a power to polarize people's opinions at times of crisis that it's a useful indicator for this study and really for the study of public monuments in the public space.